Hello friends, in this video I am going to discuss the complete comparison of involute gear and cycloidal gear on the basis of different points. So let's start the comparison between involute gear and the cycloidal gears. So here I am going to discuss the comparison on the basis of different conditions and different points. So one by one I will discuss this comparison. So in this category, the first point is related to smooth running. Here in involute gear, the profile of the gear is involute profile. So on the basis of profile, we can say this gear provide smooth running during the motion or during the engagement, it provide smooth running because of the profile. But in cycloidal gear, we consider two profile, epicycloid and hypocycloid. And because of the variation of profile, the running is less smoother compared to involute gear. So this is the first difference between involute and the cycloidal gear. Second is related to pressure angle or angle of obliquity. So if we define the pressure angle in involute gear, so it is defined between the tangent which is passing through the base circle and the tangent which is passing through the pitch point. And both the tangent are at one angle, that is called the angle of obliquity or pressure angle. So if we define the pressure angle condition for involute gear, so the angle made by the common tangent to the base circle with common tangent to the pitch circle at a pitch point, at the pitch point we consider. So this pressure angle remain constant throughout the engagement. Throughout the engagement, throughout the motion, the value of the pressure angle is not changed. But in cycloidal gear, the pressure angle continuously variable during the engagement. Here it is being zero at the pitch point and it is maximum at the point of engagement as well as at the point of disengagement. And because of this particular condition, the variation in the pressure angle, it cause continuous variation in the power transmission or continuous variation in the power component, as well as it will affect the bearing load also. So this is another difference between involute and cycloidal gear. Next difference, as I told you, this involute gear consists one profile. It consists single profile, that is called involute curve profile. And the method which we are using to generate this involute gear or to construct the involute gear, that is with the help of track cutter. With the help of track cutter, we generally manufacture this involute gear, as well as if we want to regenerate the profile of the involute teeth, or if we have a straight teeth and if we want to generate the involute tooth profile, in that case track cutter method is the best method to generate the involute profile. But in cycloidal gear, the tooth profile is divided into two parts. One is epicycloid and another is the hypocycloid. And the method which is involved to manufacture this cycloidal gear teeth profile, that is a combination of epicycloid and hypocycloid, it is more costlier than the involute gear tooth profile. This rec cutter is cheaper compared to the method which is involved to manufacture the cycloidal gear teeth. It is written here, rec cutter is cheaper and the method of manufacturing is quite simpler compared to cycloidal teeth. So it will lead the reduction in cost of manufacturing. So comparatively, the cycloidal gear is costlier than the involute gear. So in that case, we can say if there is a small variation in the center distance of the base circle we are considering, it is not changing the velocity ratio. Velocity ratio will be constant for every condition. But in cycloidal gear, we need exact center distance or definite center distance for constant velocity ratio. If we are changing the center distance of the base circle, so it will affect the velocity ratio, or there will be variation of the velocity ratio we will consider when we are changing, or if we are considering small variation in the center distance. Next point is, this involute gear doesn't exist within the base circle, and here because of this condition, interference we will consider here interference is always possible if base circle radius is larger than the dedendum circle radius. So this is another point which is related to involute gear. Now we compare this with the cycloidal gear. So here outside the pitch circle, we consider epicycloidal curve, and inside the pitch circle, we consider hypocycloidal curve for every tooth. So here, throughout this tooth profile, we consider cycloidal curve. So cycloidal curve can exist everywhere on the tooth profile, and in that case, there will be no interference exist. Here, in involute gear, there is only one profile exist, that is called the involute profile. So during the engagement, we consider interference. But in this cycloidal gear, there are two profile we consider, on the face and the flank. On the flank, it depends on the position of the gears. If it is wheel, so the face and flank will be different. And if it is pinion, so the profile of the face and flank will be different. So in that case, here we are considering two types of profile, but throughout the profile, there will be cycloidal curve, and because of this cycloidal curve, there will be no interferences existing here. Next point is the radius of curvature of the involute curve near the base circle is quite small, and contact stresses are likely to be very high. Whatever radius of the base circle we are considering, so the radius of the curvature of the involute curve, that is representing the profile of the gear, it is near the base circle, it is quite smaller. So because of the smaller radius of the curvature, the stresses generated at that particular area is very high. And tooth profile is in flank portion is almost radial. This is the construction detail of the involute gear teeth. Here, tooth profile at the flank portion, there are two portions we consider for the profile. One is the face and another is the flank. So for flank portion, it is the tooth profile is given, it is almost radial. And both the factor together produce a tooth weaker in flank region compared to cycloidal teeth. So here we have two profile. One is near the flank, that is radial, and the radius of curvature near the base circle, it is smaller. So it is representing the higher stress condition, and both the condition are representing the strength of the involute gear. So it is weaker compared to cycloidal gear. But in case of cycloidal gear, this curve which we are considering in the cycloidal gear, that is the cycloidal curve, that is the combination of hypocycloid and the epicycloid. So it produces spreading flank, and because of this reason, cycloidal tooth are stronger. The flank portion is spreaded, or it is wider compared to involute gear teeth. That is why, because of this, the stress produced at that particular area is lesser compared to involute teeth. In that case, we can say cycloidal tooth is stronger. Next point is again related to tooth profile. So as we know, involute gear tooth having only one profile, that is involute profile. So in that case, convex surface of the pinion tooth, it is in the contact with the convex portion of the gear tooth. Both the teeth here, whatever tooth we are considering for the pinion and for the gear, during the engagement, when both the teeth are mashing, so both the surfaces have convex surfaces, and both the surfaces, when it comes in contact during engagement, so both type of surfaces are same, that is convex surfaces. So convex surface of pinion tooth comes in contact with the convex portion of the gear tooth, and because of the same profile, it represent more wear. During engagement, we will consider the condition of more wear. But in case of cycloidal gear, we have two profile. One is epicycloid and another is the hypocycloid. So epicycloidal shape of the face of the gear tooth, if we are considering for gear, there is epicycloidal shape, and that is representing the face of the gear. So it is comes in contact with the flank of the another gear, that is pinion. And at that particular point, this epicycloidal shape of the face of the gear comes in contact with the hypocycloidal flank portion. In that case, there will be less wear we will consider, because convex surface of the flank will comes in contact with the concave face of the another gear or the pinion. Here, convex flank we are considering, that is representing the hypocycloidal, and that is comes in contact with the epicycloid shape of the gear. So, because of this change in profile, we will consider less wear in case of cycloidal gear. So, this is all about the difference between the involute gear and the cycloidal gear, and on the basis of application, we use involute gear and the cycloidal gear respectively. Thank you so much.